In this lecture, we'll learn about electron energy loss spectroscopy. So the overall thing what we can see is electrons, energy loss and spectroscopy. So in this particular case, we incident a particular electron beam of known energies, of known kinetic energy, and we let it interact with the material. And depending on how much energy is being lost, from that we obtain a particular spectrum to comment on. So maybe the chemical nature or the electronic state or state or the dielectric state of a particular material. So in this particular characterizing techniques, EELS, we call it electron energy loss spectroscopy, we allow a particular known set of electron energies, known kinetic energy of electron, we let it interact with the material and we see how, what is the overall loss, energy loss is occurring because of certain vibrational modes or some inelastic scattering to attain a particular spectrum. Since the overall term is energy loss, it means that the electrons are interacting inelastically. So there are certain losses. So it is not an elastic interaction, but more or less like a inelastic interaction with the material to result certain scattering. And in this particular case, we allow a known narrow range of kinetic energies. So in this particular case, we take a particular known spectrum. So we use, we can utilize say such as cylindrical mirror analyzer. So we can allow only a certain range or narrow range of kinetic energies to pass through the channel. And then once we have that known narrow range of kinetic energy of electrons, we can let it interact, we can bombard those electrons on a sample surface, and then we can measure the energy loss of a beam via this electron spectrometer. So once we attain, this is the incident energy of the electron, and later on after it has interacted with the material, we can attain an overall electron spectrum from the interaction of electron with the sample, and then we can analyze that which all processes have resulted this particular energy loss. So the known energy of electrons bombarded on a sample, then we measure the output energy. So the difference in the energy or the loss of energy is now being analyzed from the processes which are responsible for that particular loss. So then those particular processes can let us know what all interactions are occurring and what is the characteristic of a particular atom or an adsorbate or the dielectric nature of the material which are causing this particular losses. And from all those information, we can comment on many of the structures. It can be compositional, it can be dielectric, it can be ionization. So we can comment on those particular aspects of a particular material via using electron energy loss spectroscopy. So in this particular case, we are measuring the kinetic energy after they have interacted with the material, and it is definitely based on the inelastic scattering because we are worried about the loss, the electron energy loss which is occurring after the interaction, and that interaction we are measuring via supplying an only narrow range of kinetic energy of electron, and that energy range is between 1 to 10 electron volt. And then again we are analyzing those kinetic energy, and that will provide us the energy transfer which is happening because of certain surface vibrational modes. So depending on that, we can attain different kind of scattering with the material. So in this particular case, what we can that is, we have a sample, we are applying certain set of energies to interact with the sample, and again those interactions can be specular or off specular. And then once we get this particular spectrum, particular scattering, in certain cases, so we have incident energy and this is a scattered electron. So what we can get finally is scattered electron is equal to Ei minus certain losses which have occurred, h mu. So we have the overall energy of the electron which is coming out after interacting with the sample. So we have sample here, this is the incident. So incident energy minus certain energy which is now been absorbed by the material, and those are nothing but the energy losses. So that is what we are interested in, this particular term, how much energy is being lost. So we can define them that how much energy is now lost because of the inelastic scattering, and that energy is responsible for the surface vibrational modes, and that can give us much more information about the overall loss spectrum. So in this particular case, we have energy loss spectrum which is ranging between 0 to 5 to 200 electron volts, and typically the resolution is approximately 20 to 30 inverse of centimeter, whereas in certain special cases the resolution can be as better as 8 centimeter inverse. So that is what we can get from the EELS spectrum. And again in the EELS spectrum, we see a typical spectrum which appears more like this. Then initially we have a zero loss peak, then it is followed by a certain valley, and we have the first peak, and then we have high loss region. So in this case we can see energy loss along this side. This is the intensity or the frequency. So first what we see is nothing but the zero loss peak. So if you can come to the zero loss peak, so this is the zero loss peak, and in this case we are achieving the interaction of electron which are elastically scattered. So there is no loss, there is no loss of energy. So in this case the overall electron energy is same as that of incident electron. So in this case this is called a zero loss peak, because the electrons are coming back after their elastic scattering, after the elastic interaction with the material, and they result the zero loss peak. So this is the width of this particular zero loss peak will tell us about the resolution of this particular yield spectrum. And then later on we have low loss region, which is comprising of this particular region, and this case we have energy loss less than 100 electron volts, and this is basically dominated by the plasmon oscillations. So once we have some plasmon oscillations, or those of interactions which are occurring because of the polarization of electrons in a particular area, so those particular interactions, they are very very rapid, and those can be captured easily via yield spectrum. Whereas zero loss peak comprises mostly the phonon interactions, so those basically tend to heat up the material, and those energy losses are very very fine, less than 0.2-0.3 electron volts, so those can be detected by the yield spectrum. But these plasmon oscillations, they appear in the low loss region, and from that we can detect much more of the dielectric nature or the composition of a particular material. So the first peak, the zero loss peak, provides like the resolution of the yield spectrum. The low loss region provides more of the composition or the dielectric nature of a particular material, and in the high loss region we have greater than 100 electron volts or greater than 50 electron volts, we can get a spectrum which tells much about the bonding or the ionization structure of a particular material. So in this case we can see inertial ionizations, which is rare because energy is low, but we can see those spectrum very easily in the high loss region around this side. So we see high loss region, we see a low loss region, and we see a zero loss peak in the yield spectrum. And generally the resolution, spectral resolution, is generally approximately 1 electron volt for this particular spectrum. So we can't really measure which energy losses when they are lesser than 1 electron volt, such as phonon losses, they comprise between 0.2-0.3 electron volts. So those can be really detected by the yield spectrum. And there are a variety of manners in which energy can be lost, and those all have to be inelastic interaction, because some energy is being absorbed by the material. So we can have phonon excitations, we can have inter and intra band transitions, we can also have plasmon excitations, we can also have inertial ionizations, and at the same time we can also have some negative ion resonance. So phonon excitation, it means that we are allowing some lattice vibrations to occur, and those tend to heat up the material, and the energy losses are very very low in this particular case. We can also have inter and intra band transitions, so in that particular case we can have electron jumping from one shell to another shell, or from higher shell to another shell, and then even between two different atoms. So that is nothing but the inter and intra band transitions, and within a particular shell there can be some transitions between between the 2p1 and 2p23. So that part can also happen as a intra band transition. We can also have some plasmon excitations, that means the localization or the polarization of the electrons in a particular entity, and then that can also lead to the absorption of the energy. We can also have some inertial ionization. We can allow an electron to get ionized, an atom to get ionized by release of an electron. At the same time, we can also see certain negative ion resonance. In that particular case, we can have certain different transitions which can allow electron to stay for much longer time in a certain molecular orbital. So electron will stay trapped for a certain time. So it might appear that energy is being absorbed for a certain duration of time. So those are certain energy losses which can occur, and those can be incorporated in the yield spectrum. But these are the losses which are basically contributing to the energy loss spectrum, but it doesn't mean that all the losses can be easily visualized, such as phonon losses, they can't be really resolved in the yield spectrum. And again, there can be variety of scattering which can occur. In this case, in the dipole scattering, we have scattering to a long range, hundreds of angstroms, via strong Coulombic field. So if an electron is coming interacting with the surface, and it goes off via certain loss in the momentum in the horizontal direction. So in this particular case, the perpendicular momentum is now conserved. So we can see that the perpendicular motion is now conserved. So we have the similar perpendicular line, but the horizontal part is basically being lost. So horizontal momentum is basically being lost. So that's part we see here, or so much energy is being absorbed by the electron in the horizontal direction. So in this particular case, in the dipole scattering, we can achieve scattering in case of because of Coulombic fields, and in this particular case, we have the retention of the momentum in the perpendicular direction, but there is loss of momentum in the horizontal direction. It is happening because of the Coulombic field of the surface. It can also attain certain out of plane scattering can also occur, and in this particular case, we have kinematic scattering. And that is only for a shorter range, in couple of angstrom. But in this particular case, when an electron is basically interacting with the material, it is losing both perpendicular as well as the horizontal momentum. So in this particular case, whatever the distances we had, momentums we had in the horizontal and vertical direction, those are basically being lost in both the cases. So we have some extra loss in this part as well as some extra loss in the vertical direction. So we have loss in vertical direction as well as some loss in the horizontal direction, and that occurs because of certain strong nuclear motions or vibrations, and that that results some potentials on the surface, and because of that electron gets scattered over wide range of angles. So angles are much wider, but they are at short ranges, few angstrom. So they go in and out of the plane of incidence, and we are not able to retain the electron momentum in both the directions, which are both parallel in the perpendicular direction. So we had dipole scattering, and that we were able to retain the momentum in the perpendicular direction, but because of impact scattering, those are occurring because of the nuclear motions or vibrations, and in that particular case we achieve very wide range of angles but for a shorter distances, and in that particular case we destroy both the perpendicular and the perpendicular and the parallel motion or the momentum of the electron. And again, we can also have some negative ion resonance, and in that particular case we can induce some impurities, and those basically induce some molecular orbitals that can come because of the adsorbate. So we have incident electron beam, it interacts with the sample, but since there are some adsorbates which are present on the surface of a particular sample, they generate some extra molecular orbitals, and because of that the electron can stay trapped out there, or the so our electron can stay transiently trapped on those particular empty or high lying molecular orbitals, and because of that some energy is being basically utilized out there, and that vibrational feature intensity, it strongly depends on the incident energy or the which causes the resonance. So that is also happening. We have dipole scattering, we had impact scattering, and we can also have negative ion resonance scattering. In that particular case, we are able to have the electron being transiently trapped in certain molecular orbitals for certain duration of time. But though these are some loss features, most of the interaction is occurring elastically. So we get the strongest peak is coming out because of the elastic interaction, and that basically takes care of the zero loss peak. So basically our overall spectrum of the loss spectrum, or the overall loss spectrum, is generally very very weak, because major of the phenomena, they are occurring elastically. So that is the reason our the spectrum which is coming out as a loss spectra, it is generally very very weak. So eventually our detection system has to be strong enough to be able to detect that weak spectrum and comment on the overall nature or the structure or the composition of the sample. So that is what the overall feel of the EELS spectroscopy is. And depending on what kind of information we have, so we can have collective oscillations. They can come out either from plasmons, or they can come out of phonons. So plasmons are nothing but the collective oscillations of free electrons. So in this particular case, we have polarization of electrons, and electrons are generally very free entities. So they tend to be dispersed like in a metal matrix. So we have it is basically predominant in metals. When we have high density of electrons which are floating without any bonding to the bonding to a particular atom, so they are flowing freely on a metal surface. And they cause basically the most common inelastic interactions, but the problem with them is they die out very quickly in 10 to the power minus 15 seconds, and they're also localized to less than 10 nanometer, and they can they basically are scattered to less than 0.1 millirads, and their energy is approximately 5 to 25 electron volt. So once they have energy much greater than 1 electron volt, these particular signals can be easily captured by the yield spectrum. So we can see that the plasmon losses, they arise because of the localized polarization of the electrons, because they arise from the collective oscillations of electrons, and they are very predominant in the metals. So because they have very high electron density, and because their energy losses are in the order of 5 to 25 electron volt, they can be easily captured by the yield spectrum. On the other hand, we can also have some phonon oscillations. Those are the collective oscillations of atoms, or they also arise because of the lattice vibrations. And because of that, they tend to generate heat, and they tend to heat up the specimen. And they can also be generated by certain other inelastic processes, such as Auger energy or the X-ray energy, and those can also cause the lattice vibrations or the oscillations of the atoms. But the problem with them is they generally tend to have a very low energy loss, which is to the order of less than 0.1 electron volt. And since it is less than the resolution limit of yields, which is approximately 1 electron volt, we are not able to detect all these losses in the yield spectrum. And the one more thing is that the phonon can get scattered to a very large angles, to the order of 5 to 15 millirads. And because of that, they can generally give a very high or the diffuse background in the case of phonon. So the collective oscillations, they are limited to plasmons and phonons. And plasmons, they are collective oscillations of electrons, whereas phonons tend to be the collective oscillations of atoms. And depending on what kind of energy losses they have, we can get a certain spectrum, which can basically grab the particular picture, or the density of electrons can be easily captured by the plasmon peak or the low loss energy, low loss regime of the yield spectrum. So overall, we can see that our phonon excitations, they are limited to 0.2 electron volt, and they give out us a very diffuse background, and they basically come out in the zero loss peak. And since they are very low, the overall energy loss is very, very low, they can't get resolved. And because of that, it can create certain problem in the resolution of a particular yield spectrum. At the same time, they tend to heat up the specimen. So anyway, those particular things appear in the zero loss peak, and they tend to heat up the specimen. Then later on, we can also have some intra-band transitions, and that can provide us a signature. So in the low loss region, we can get some signals which are basically between the 5 to 25 electron volts. And those transitions can be easily captured, which can provide us a structure of a particular material. And plasmon excitations, they can be limited either as a surface plasmons or as a bulk plasmon, and their energy again comes in the low loss region. And we can in the surface plasmons, we have basically the transverse waves, which can provide they are basically half the energy of the bulk plasmons. And the bulk plasmon, we generally have interaction as the longitudinal wave. And this particular spectrum can be easily attained in the low loss region. And later on, once we have much higher loss, so that is basically being created by the inertial ionization, and that generally is greater than 100 electron volt. And from that, we can always attain a elemental information, because we know what are the transitions or the ionizations which are responsible for causing this much loss of the energy. So so overall, we can see that we have a zone distributed in three regimes. We have zero loss peak. Zero loss peak, basically it defines the overall energy resolution. Higher the basically energy loss, the poorer is the resolution, because the broader the particular peak is, the poorer the resolution will be, and higher the kV, the poorer will be the resolution. And again, this thing is arising because of the forward scattering, which is to the order of a few millirads. And again, as we saw that the overall broadening is because of the phonons, which basically give out a diffuse pattern. And again, this corresponds to more like the zero spot of the diffraction pattern. And again, the bright diffracted peak, which are to the order of 20 millirads, they rarely enter the spectrometer. So we have this much particular resolution, which is now been the constraining factor. And this also includes the energy loss of 0.3 electron volts, which comes out from the phonon interaction. And so though it is including the phonon losses, it is not able to resolve those phonon losses. So we can see that zero loss peak, it is responsible for the overall defining the overall resolution or the energy resolution of the spectrometer. And later we have a plasmon peak, and then we have a high energy loss peak. So so again, in the this is again the kind of a valley before the plasmon peak. And the information what you can get from the plasmon peak is basically the overall dielectric nature of a material. So we can get the overall dielectric nature of a particular material, and also we can find the composition. Whereas the high loss regime, it can provide us much more information on the overall ionization structure or the bonding, because those ionizations are occurring in this particular high loss regime. And then again we have energy loss which is near the edge structure. So this is the edge, and we have energy loss near the edge structure. And whereas this regime is the extended energy loss fine structure. So we have either the fine structure or near edge structure, and again it is in the high loss region. And from this we can get much more of the bonding effects, how is the overall bonding which is happening, and we can also attain overall diffraction effect which can occur from the atoms surrounding the ionized atom. So we can get much more information as either energy loss fine structure or as energy loss near the edge structure. So we have a regime which is nothing but the zero loss peak, and then we have low loss peak which is limited to 50 to 100 electron volt, and then we have high energy loss regime which is basically the either it can be a fine structure or the near edge structure, and from that we can get much more bonding or the ionization effects. So again there are different parts of the spectrum. So again coming to the initial part, we already saw that this is nothing but the zero loss peak. So we have incident beam energy, it's interacting with the material and it is getting elastically interacted, and that energy is being captured back as the zero loss peak, because the incident electron, they have not lost any energy while interacting with the specimen. So they result out the zero loss peak, and later on they have plasmon peak. In this case we are observing plasmon losses. Those are arising because of the polarization of the electrons, and because of that material is losing certain energy via certain oscillations. And we have one regime of valley before the plasmon peak, and then again the plasmon peak. So in this case we tend to see this particular peak because of the free electron density, and that can tell us much more about the dielectric constant of the particular specimen as well as the composition of the specimen. So so that part we can attain from the plasmon peak or the low loss regime, that we can comment because the distribution of electrons or the polarization of electrons will tell about the dielectric nature of the material, how easily the electrons can flow and how easily they can reduce the energy loss. So that part can be easily obtained, and again we can also from that we can also attain the overall composition of the specimen from the free electron density. Second, from the high energy loss regime, we have near edge structure and the fine structure which is the extended region, and it can arise as more than the critical energy for the ionization is imparted to the core electron. So from that we can attain what is the overall ionization which is happening out there, and it is basically the excess energy which is approximately few electron volts. We can also attain some pleural elastic scattering, and that can give us the bonding structure between the two atoms. And if the excess energy is greater, and that can be correlated to the single scattering event, and that can provide us the local atomic arrangement. So we can achieve the bonding between the atoms, or what is happening in terms of the arrangement of the local atoms. So we can get overall structure, either the bonding of the ionized atom, how the ionized atom is coordinated to the other atoms from the overall arrangement, and that can also provide us the density of states of the solid as well as the radial distribution function for all these entities. So that part we can attain from the extended regimes of the which is near edge and the extended fine structure. So that information we can get from the high energy loss spectrum, either from the energy loss near edge structure which is the ELNES, or from the extended energy loss fine structure, that is EXELFS. So we can attain that much information from out here. So later on we can also see that the overall information what we can get from here is, if we get an intensity, so we are getting certain intensity out here, and then in this case we have energy loss which is an EV. So we have energy loss, so we are seeing one first peak which is coming out exactly at zero, and then we have a very fine plasmon losses, and that's it, and then we have high loss period. So if we start basically extending it or increasing magnifying it, so this is nothing but a zero loss peak, and then we can go back and see this particular regime. So this is nothing but the plasmon peak. If we start magnifying it, then we can see that we are seeing certain peaks. So at certain higher peaks we can see that there's some information which can be available and these regimes occur basically at around 100 electron volts. So this is the low loss region, and we can start seeing something at much at the high loss regime. High loss. Again, this is high loss. So we can start magnifying it. So in this particular case, we are seeing zero loss peak. Those are nothing but the arising from the elastic scattering, and that can tell us more about the resolution part of this particular yield spectrum. And then once we are going and seeing the plasmon losses, we can tell much more about the dielectric nature or the composition. And as we see here, we can have some certain spectrum. So in this case, it can be silicon L shell. So we can get certain information about the bonding, that what kind of energy is responsible for creating this particular ionization. It can also be arising from some other material, say K of carbon. So this particular part tells us two things. First of all, what is overall bonding? Because this is nothing but the ionization energy, so that is telling directly about the bonding. And then it can also tell us about the oxidation state, whether how much energy is basically being provided here. So from that we can also get the oxidation state, and we can also know what the overall concentration, because depending on the height of this particular peak, we can know how much carbons are really interacting to give out this particular intensity or giving out this particular regime. And we can also see that there can be certain secondary peaks out here, so we can further magnify it. So we can see the extension of this one. So if this can be 50x, this can be 500x, and this can again be 1000x. So at later on, we can also again see some more peaks which can be, say, may belong to oxygen, say K from the K shell. So from one spectrum, we can keep magnifying it. So the blue one, what we saw earlier, is the initial spectrum. Then we magnify it by 50 times, and then we see certain spectrum that tells much more information about whether there is some silicon in it. It will tell us about the bonding or the oxidation state. We magnify it further to say 500x, and then what we get, we can see some carbon, presence of some carbon, and that will tell us about the overall concentration of carbon. We can magnify it further, and what we see is some presence of some oxygen. So we can get a couple of information from here: the bonding, the oxidation state, and the concentration, even the electronic structure of this particular entity. Those are information we can get very easily from the yield spectrum. So that is what we can see in this particular case. Further, we can also do some yield microanalysis, and in this particular case, we can even detect a single atom of thorium even on a carbon film. So if we see, we can get a particular spectrum. We can get a particular spectrum, and in the low loss regime, we can see some presence of some thorium. If I had a particular film, so I can get some signals which are basically for carbon. This peak is coming from a thorium with a cluster of thorium. But if I only have one single atom of thorium, this is the energy loss, the intensity, and I can also compare it with say if I had certain peaks of carbon, and then if I allow only one thorium atom to basically get adsorbed on the surface, I do see some bump out here, and with a similar kind of a carbon peak. So I can even detect, even when I have single thorium atom which is now adsorbed on the carbon surface, I still will be able to detect that particular part. So that tells how sensitive that yield spectrum is, that I can detect even a single thorium atom. So I can detect that because the thorium atom, if it forms a cluster, I can still see the similar peak at the similar energy loss regime, and that might be either at lower energy or maybe less than 100 electron volt. So that part I can see from the yield microanalysis, and I can detect even a single atom of thorium on a carbon film. So that is the overall sensitivity of the yield spectrum. So in this particular case, I had a carbon film, so I do see the peaks which are arising because of carbon, and those are generally in the high loss regime, so they can tell me about the overall excitation nature or the bonding nature of the electrons in the ionization state. So I can get much more information of what are the transitions which are occurring in the carbon alone. So depending on what kind of carbon it is, I can get the pi interactions or the sigma interactions which are occurring for the electrons. And for the thorium, it is now adsorbed on the carbon surface, so I am getting a much bulk or the peak on the carbon film, and that is because of the cluster of thorium atoms. But even when I have single thorium atom sitting on the surface of carbon as an adsorbate, I can still detect that. So that is the overall sensitivity of the yield spectrum. So again, in certain cases, we have diamond, graphite and fullerene, and again they only have carbon in it, nothing else. So we are considering three systems: diamond, graphite, and fullerene, and they all consist because basically carbon, but they have absorption peaks of around 284 electron volt in the E spectrum, which correspond to the existence of carbon atom. So we see 284. We have certain regime of carbon which is present. So we do see that the carbon is present out there, and from the fine structure of the absorption peak, the difference in the bonding state and the local electronic state can be detected. So you can find the bonding and the local electronic state from the fine structure of the E spectrum. And again, if we go further, we can see for the graphite, we have this particular bonding, which is 1s or the pi bonding. 1s to the pi bonding, we have a certain energy absorption. So we are able to see this particular peak in the graphite, and the similar peak we can also see in the C60, but that peak is totally absent in the diamond structure. So we can see that because diamond we have sp3 hybridization, so we don't have a transition which can really see 1s to going to the empty pi bond. So we can see that carbon K shell electron from 1s, it is not able to bond to yield a pi bonding orbital in case of diamond. So that can be very nicely being observed out here. That the sharp peak at the absorption edge, which corresponds to the excitation of the carbon K shell electron or the 1s electron to the empty antibonding pi orbital, that is present only in the graphite as well as in the C60, because they both have sp2 type of hybridization. So they still have one orbital in p which is empty. So there can be a transition from the s shell or the 1s shell to the p bond, and that particular energy regime is following in the regime out here. And from this we can say that the diamond, we have sp3 hybridization, and there is no empty pi electron basically which can come out here. So there is no 1s electron which can jump to the empty pi electron, and that is the reason we have this particular energy level vacant out there. So that is the kind of information we can get, that from a difference between the graphite, C60 and the diamond, where everything is now composed of carbon only, and that thing is now being captured from the yield spectrum. So in the yield spectrum, we can see that if we have large number of particular electrons at say 284 eV, that's what we saw. So we have overall spectrum, and then from 280 we are seeing very large number of spectrum. This thing is at 284 electron volt. So from this we directly know that we have energy loss happening much more at the 284, and it means that there is some entity, some ionization which is happening at this particular level only because some particular atom is present, and that is leading to this particular energy loss. So this happens to be an electron energy loss which equals to the ionization of carbon from K shell. So if a K shell electron present in the carbon atom, and that equals to the energy of that particular electron equals to 284 eV. So directly means that if we have loss which is happening at 284 electron volt, so we have energy loss out here in eV, and we have intensity out here. So once we see a very high intensity, exactly 284 electron volt, we can directly correlate it to the ionization of carbon from the K shell. So that directly tells us that we have some atom present out here, and that is leading to the ionization of this particular atom, and incident beam is somehow interacting with this particular atom, and it is ionizing the carbon. So that is the first information what we can get from here, that this particular energy is equal to the energy which is required to remove an electron from the K shell of the carbon. So this tells we have presence of carbon, and the intensity of this also tells us what is the approximate composition or the approximate content of this particular carbon, because the more the carbon, the higher the intensity of this peak at 284 electron volt. So we can also say that there is a significant amount of carbon which is present in the material, and from that, from the interaction as we saw, if we have a certain bonding or bonding present, so from S shell to the P, from the pi shell, if we see that particular peak, it means that type of a bonding can be present. If not, that it means it is not there. So we can also find what is the type of atom, its overall amount and number of atoms of each type. So in case we have certain hybridization which is happening, so we can know whether we have atoms which have sp2 hybridization or sp3 hybridization which is present in a particular case. And also we can find the scattering angles. So depending on the from the width, we can also find the overall scattering angles, and that can provide us much more of the dispersion relations for a particular atom. So from this overall information from the Yield spectrum, first of all we can identify where the particular peak is getting, where we are getting the exact peak, and that will tell us how much energy loss is occurring, and that from that we can correlate it to the ionization of a particular entity, say carbon in this case. That will tell us the amount of carbon, type of bonding which is happening, the overall scattering angle from the dispersion for a particular entity. So all this information we can get easily from a Yield spectrum. And how do we get that is, we have electron source, and first of all we are providing a narrow range of kinetic energy. So we have narrow range of kinetic energy, and that thing is being achieved from a cylindrical mirror analyzer, or it can also we have certain two cylinders out there, and we apply certain bias to it. So we have energy less than E naught, it gets basically gets entrapped out there. If I have E greater than E naught, then it gets entrapped out here. So what we can get out is a narrow range of energy which has limited E naught, and that particular energy of known E naught value will now interact with the sample. And once it interacts with the sample, after the interaction, how much energy is being lost by the electron, that thing is again sent back to the analyzer. And on the analyzer, we can again do the same operation, and we can select what all energies are coming out. So by putting the bias, certain biases to the particular analyzer, we can somehow detect the overall spectrum from a detector. So we can get overall spectrum of what is the overall energy loss which is happening. Because once we know the incident energy minus the energy which is being observed later on, that is nothing but equal to the energy loss which is occurring for a particular electron. So that is what we are getting it from the overall spectrum. That we are sending certain energy, we have electron source, we are sending it through a monochromator to get a particular set of known narrow range of kinetic energy for electron, and those are interacting with the sample, and upon interaction with the sample, it is now sent to an analyzer. So those will separate out the energies. Once we are able to separate out the energies, we know the incident energy, we know the final energy. So the subtraction of that Ei minus Es will tell us how much energy loss is now occurring, and that energy loss is now being correlated to the overall structure of a particular for a particular material, or even from for a even we can also find out the overall dielectric nature or the ionization state or the bonding state for a particular material, and that thing we are getting from this Yield spectrum. And again, the advantages of the Yield spectrum, it basically can be applied to materials which are normally unstable under electron beam, because in this particular case our energies are very low. So, because our energies are very low, we can also apply it to the materials which are basically unstable under an electron beam. And again, in this particular case, we can have multiple scattering occurring, because as we saw, we have a dipole scattering, we can also have a specular scattering, we have impact scattering, dipole scattering, and we can also have some negative ion resonance. So, all those mechanisms have behave very differently. In one case, we can retain the momentum in the perpendicular state. In the second case, the momentum was not at all conserved, both parallel as well as perpendicular, and all those basically scattering mechanisms are allowed, and that will allow us to observe the overall energy loss. So we can observe all the modes which are parallel and perpendicular to the surface, so that can reveal much more information. At the same time, we can observe modes between 0 to 4000 inverse of centimeter, and also we can attain spectrums which have a lower energy or the lower frequency modes. We can also attain the spectrum for that, and that basically we can also observe the molecule surface. So that part gives us the information much more about the what is happening at the surface level or at the low energy losses. Also we can attain, and again we can perform vibrational and electronic loss spectroscopy. We can also induce and probe current induced interactions with the variable incident energy. In this case, we don't need any background subtraction, because we know what is the incident beam and what is the beam intensity which is coming out. So we don't need to do any background subtraction, and it is very common technique for the surface and bulk phonon measurements, because that will create the initial broadening of the zero loss peak. So that part we can tell very nicely what is the overall surface and bulk phonon interaction which is happening with the material. And in this particular case, we can find the atomic composition. So we can also attain what is the atomic composition which is out there, what is the overall chemical bonding which is happening in the material, because from the intensity of a particular yield peak, we can find what is the overall how much is the overall presence of a particular entity which is causing this particular increase in the peak intensity. So that can tell us about the overall composition, and it can tell us about the overall bonding nature, because depending on where the particular peak is appearing. So like in the case of carbon, from 1s2 pi shell, we saw that peak was operating at 284 electron volt. If it is not present, we can tell much more about the bonding nature of carbon itself. So we know whether it's sp2 or sp3 hybridization, and again it can tell us about the valence and electronic band electron profile. So that part can also be obtained from the ionization part. We can also get much more of surface properties, because we saw even when a single thorium atom is present on a carbon surface, it can be basically detected. So this particular instrument is highly sensitive, so we can get much more information even from the yield spectrum. And again, we can find the element specific pair distribution function, as we know, as we had seen earlier, from the distribution of the specular scattering, we can find the correlation between the radial profile. So that can also provide us much more information about how the specific pair distance is now being distributed. So that part we can also obtain in this particular yield spectrum. So overall advantages are that it is basically we can find atomic composition, we can also find the chemical bonding, we can also find the valence and conduction band profiles, we can get surface properties, we can also get some element specific properties, and it can also give us the modes which are lower frequency mode, less than 400 centimeter inverse, and we can perform many vibrational electronic loss spectroscopy, and we can also find some phonon measurements. We can also do some phonon measurements, and also we don't need to do any background corrections for in this particular spectrum. So these are certain advantages of the yield spectrum. What we can get, very fine detailed information, but there are a couple of challenges out here, that it has a poor resolution. The best it can achieve is approximately 6 to 8 inverse of centimeter, and since we have very low energy electrons which are utilized in this particular case, we can work only in the ultra high vacuum, out of the order of 10 to power minus 10 to 12 torr. So that is the overall regime we need to work in, because the electrons need to travel very large distances so that they can reach the detector. So we need to perform all these operations under ultra high vacuum. So that is the most problem with it. And that makes it very expensive. It is very complex, because we need to generate first of all a monochromatic beam, and then let it pass through analyzer, and then again get it detected. So again, it is very complex, and it requires a delicate instrumentation, because we also need to detect what is the beam energy, kinetic energy, and what is the energy we are getting after it has interacted with the sample. At the same time, electrons should be maintained well within the ultra high vacuum. So that makes it very very delicate. It requires very delicate instrumentation. We also detect some spectral information in terms of the dispersion or the diffused spectrum what we get. So that tells more about the phonon interactions, and that makes the instrumentation much delicate. And thus attaining the spectrum is a little slower, 15 to 60 minutes per spectrum. And again, it can also result some surface charging, because we are dealing with the flow of electrons on the sample surface, some plasmon oscillations. So it can also lead to surface charging. So generally, conducting samples are much more preferred in this particular case. So again, it also has a very difficult theory, because depending on what all ionizations are occurring, how the losses are occurring, they require exact identification of how those processes are leading to the loss in energy, and that makes the theory a little difficult to grasp. So the overall advantages include that it needs to be worked in ultra high vacuum. It requires very sophisticated instrumentation. It is very complex, and it's very expensive, and it is a little slower, 15 to 60 minutes, and it has a poor resolution in comparison to the reflection absorption infrared spectroscopy. So that makes it much more poorer resolution. But despite that, it is still very very appealing, and and in comparison to the EDAX, in the yields we can just basically have a correlation between the yields and the EDAX. And then like an EDAX, we have sensitivity for higher atomic number elements, whereas for the yields, we have high detection efficiency for the low atomic number elements. So that is one part out here. And in EDAX, we can get only elemental information, but in this case, yields, we can get elemental, we can get chemical, as well as we can get the dielectric information. So that in that part, we can get the composition, we can also get the ionization state, and those all information we can get easily from the yields. In the EDAX, we have energy resolution limited to 100 electron volts, whereas in this particular case, we have approximately 1 electron volt. So in this particular case, energy resolution is much higher as compared to EDAX, and we can also get we generally tend to give less number of peak overlaps. It can also provide us very fine structure for the ionization edge. So this part also we can get from the yields. And in case of EDAX, we have inefficient signal collection, and that makes it very, very time consuming. That elemental mapping generally becomes very, very time consuming in this particular case. But in yields, we have very high or efficient signal collection, because it is highly sensitive, and it can detect even a single thorium atom, which is if it is sitting on a carbon film, and that makes it very, very efficient in terms of mapping. So it can provide efficient elemental mapping on a particular surface. At the same time, since it is very efficient, it becomes very fast technique. It's fast technique, but it requires very complex theory. Though EDAX is little slow, it is much more simpler, and we can get a spectrum very, very quick. But again, this is a slow process, a slow technique, but it can have very simpler processing is required in the EDAX. So that is the overall thing about yields, that we can we are incidenting known electron energy, and we are letting it interact with the material. And from the detection of the loss which has occurred upon interaction of electron with the material, and from that energy we can distinguish the overall spectrum, either a zero loss, low loss, and the high loss. In the zero loss, we have mostly the elastic scattering, and that tells us much about the phonon losses which are occurring in the material. Then later on, we have the plasmon losses, and then plasmon losses basically are the main thing which can tell us more about the overall composition of the information, compositional or the dielectric nature of the material. Whereas in the high loss regime, we can see the near edge structure or the fine structure, which is near the extended which is called the extended energy loss fine structure. So we can get some information out from there, which tells us more about the ionization state, or what is the ionization of a particular material, or also about the bonding which is predominant in that particular location. And all those information we can get from the high loss regime in the yield spectrum. And as we see, it is a very sensitive technique, and it can detect very fine adsorbates which are there on the surface of a particular entity or a particular surface. And this can serve as a very fine tool in terms of resolution, in terms of resolving any adsorbates which are there on the sample surface. So basically, with that, I'll end my lecture here. Thank you.